I was posted yesterday, and I had thought that the last day of classes was the 5th of December, the Thursday. But I just learned that that's in fact the last time I will see you is on the Tuesday, the 3rd. So the assignment then is due that last day of class. I intended it to be the 5th. I didn't realize there's no class on the 5th, so the due date is the 3rd of December. I'll update the website right away. So you have a week to do the assignment. I hope that you have a week in 2 days. We have a week, however, to complete it. There's no late hand-ins. I'll post the solutions right after that class. So no electronic hand-ins late, no paper hand-ins late will be accepted for that final assignment. So then we have 2-3 days to study the solutions for the final exam, which is on Saturday. Okay. Is there any misunderstanding?
Depending on when the professor website says everything gets back up, seems to be it still hasn't come out, the internet hasn't come back. So is there any way you need to email us the assignment? Just because we can't communicate.
You can access the assignment, my websites are on campus.
I wasn't able to access them.
I can sit in my office and access it.
It sometimes would let you, and other times
it won't. Yeah, I try to get on the phone.
But I can't email it to you because you won't receive it easily. So what I can do is I can print it and make it available in the office for you to pick up.
I just don't know.
Yeah, I mean, so fix it today. If it's not at the backup today, I will have copies of the assignments available to pick up in the office tomorrow. So please note that revised due date then to accommodate. Let's also just talk quickly about Quest. So what is the intention of Quest? Quest is based on some scientific research in the psychology literature that shows it is far better to learn in an interleaved manner than into a blocked manner. So what do we mean by that? If you space your learning over time, you are far more effective at recalling that information later on. So Quest is a way, part of my educational research, that's looking at some of that issues, but it's also a way to help you pace your learning. So you're not going to be cramming for 4M on Friday for Saturday's exam. Quests are going to be 2 more quests that will take 10 minutes each one, and there will be a few questions on adsorption, liquid-liquid extraction, and drying, so you get some extra practice for the final exams. So there's no more than, it shouldn't take you longer than 10 minutes to do it, though you will have a 45-minute block to write it. But if you know this stuff and you've been coming to class like all of you have, then it's simply just a quick application of the examples we've done in class. It shouldn't take you too much time, and I absolutely recognize that your time allocation for all the courses is critical over the next 2 weeks, right? So I know absolutely the pressure you're under to have due dates for projects and so forth, which is one reason why you notice in 4M and in 4N I schedule all of that far, far ahead than the other courses can mess you around. Okay, but quests shouldn't take more than 10 minutes of your time. You should be able to find the time within the day to do that. Okay, so 2 more of those will be coming up. Let's take a look at our new topic. This will be probably our final topic that we actually study something in depth. I plan to have 1 review class, and time permitting, I have plans for a bit of discussion on bioseparations. This may be the last topic, though, bioseparations. I'm hoping to at least have 1 class on that as well. Let's take a look at what drying is. The reason why this comes at this point in the course structure is because drying now starts to take into account both mass and heat transfer. So up to this point, when we've looked at our separation monocrystals, they've either been mass transfer or heat transfer driven. Here, we're going to be looking at both mass and heat transfer. So what I mean by that is that if you think of sedimentation, cyclones, liquid-liquid extraction, membranes, all of those you're pushing some form of mass around. In your 3M course, you've been looking at distillation quite intensively, and that's an energy transfer-based process. So here, we're bringing the two together to dry solid parts. So we're going to have our liquid phase, water that we're going to be removing from our solid phase. And to do that, we're going to apply an ESA, our energy separating agent here, some form of thermal energy. We're going to add to the system to try and remove liquids from the solid. And the reason why we also look at it at this point in the course, and not earlier, is because it's the final step in many flow sheets. So one thing I don't get about many of the separations textbooks, Giancopoulos, Cedar, Henley, and Roper, they all put drying near the beginning. It makes absolutely no sense to be coming into a topic where you have to apply heat transfer, mass transfer, correlations, and it doesn't make any sense from the structure of how we deal with it. Drying is almost always the last unit operation in a flow sheet. And it also brings in mass transfer and energy transfer, or heat transfer, so you should be thinking of it near the end of a course like this. But let's take a look why it's used. Well, mainly that when we package product that's dry, it's a lot easier to do that. Material that's dry flows a lot better than a moist or wet material. It reduces the shipping weight. So for many reasons, those two are probably the most predominant. The weight of your product that you're shipping to your customer is much, much lower. So you can save a tremendous amount of money on that. The other reason, and especially true for food products and pharmaceuticals, crops and grains, those first three over there, is that removing the moisture will inhibit bacterial growth. The bacteria will require moisture to grow. If we remove that below the limits where that's favorable, we can prevent our product from being spoiled. And particularly for food products, removing the moisture can stabilize that product and prolong its shelf life. The other thing is that's quite interesting about food products in particular, food products rely on very specific and very narrow ranges of moisture to be present for you to enjoy that food product. So think of a piece of toast. You bite into that toast, if you haven't toasted it for long enough, is it satisfying to eat it? Right? It doesn't have that crispiness there, right? If you haven't toasted it for long enough, it's pretty unsatisfying biting into that piece of toast. If you over-toast it, other than burning it, or if you toast it and you leave it out a day, and then you come back tomorrow and you say, oh, there's my toast, I forgot to eat, and you bite into it, it's like that eating that Swedish bread you buy at IKEA, right? It's so, so crispy that your whole head vibrates kind of when you touch it. So, very, very narrow ranges of crispiness make foods have their desirable properties. There's actually a name for it. They're called organoleptic properties. There's a whole science of the vibrations that get set up in your skull when you bite into certain types of snack foods. Okay, so getting that crispiness just to the right level makes the product have a desirable property. And then furthermore, certain properties so corrosion, for example, you're shipping a product in a metal container, corrosion can occur, so you need three elements for corrosion to occur. You need the corrodent, which is moisture, and when air combined, you need the metal as well. And if you remove that moisture phase, you prevent corrosion from occurring. So it's like the fire triangle, we have a corrosion triangle. If you remove one of the elements, moisture in this case, the corrodent, then you inhibit corrosion. So many good reasons for studying this topic, and again, let's just quickly go back here. You'll see it in a wide variety of typical areas of application. Now, our understanding of moisture is very, very poor. From a first principles point of view, we cannot model the relationship between the solid and the liquid phase. So what I mean by that is if we take a piece of solid, think of a piece of pet food, a piece of cornflakes, so some sort of solid. You can think of your clothing. If you put moisture onto that clothing and you look at it under a microscope, it's going to have pieces of fabric, and then you're going to have water molecules around it, and then fabric again. Here's my water and my solid and pieces of water in between. We cannot model that relationship between the attraction forces between the water and the solid phase. From the first principles point of view, it's too complex. Right? There's a very, very complex force structure in the fibers that make up this clothing, and so it's very hard to model what that's going to do and predict what it's going to do. So what we do is we simply revert to correlations. Take a look at what's up here. What are we plotting on the x-axis and y-axis? And what does this plot remind you of? we seen one of these before?
It looks like absorption isotherms.
Looks like absorption isotherms. What if we plotted an isotherm on the x-axis?
Concentration
versus
concentration on the absorbent.
Okay, so in an isotherm, we plotted on the horizontal axis the concentration of A, the species we're interested in, per meter cubed of fluid. Here, we're plotting relative humidity. Relative humidity, I'll show you in a minute what that definition is, just to remind you again. But essentially, it's telling you the concentration of water in air. And on the vertical axis over there, we've got equilibrium moisture content, kilograms of water per kilogram of material. Like the isotherm, that's kilograms of A, the solute, per kilogram of adsorbent. So this is essentially nothing more than the isotherm, but we don't call it that. Okay? So it's telling us the relationship at equilibrium between moisture and the solid material we're dealing with. So if we take cotton, for example, that's its curve. We can go and say, if I put a piece of clothing or cotton in an environment which has 40% humidity, so that's maybe a typical day in Ontario at some point in the year, there's 40% humidity outside, and you hang your piece of clothing to dry, that piece of clothing, the weight of that clothing, if you to go measure, weigh it, it's not just the weight of the fabric itself. There's some moisture that's attached to that fabric, even if you leave it in the sun in 40% humidity for an infinite period of time, there's water on that fabric still. Not all of the water evaporates. In fact, you can go calculate and show them that 5 kilograms of moisture per 100 kilograms of material will be remaining on that cotton. So it's never totally dry. In fact, the only time you can get your piece of clothing 100% dry is putting it in an environment where there's no humidity. Okay, so materials, this is an important point, will have some form of equilibrium moisture on them. So if you think of this from a practical perspective, you dry, say, pet food, or you dry cornflakes, or you're drying a catalyst that you're shipping to your customer. If you have the isotherm for it, there's no point in over-drying it, because if you leave that material exposed to the atmosphere to a certain amount of humidity, there's always a non-zero humidity in the air, the material will just simply reabsorb that moisture. Okay, so it will come to some form of equilibrium on the curve for that product. So there's no point in over-drying it. And that's why products that rely on it being dry when it's shipped, so for example, think of your potato chips that you open, they're shipped in sealed bags. Because they know that when you open that bag of chips, you're going to eat it, there's a desired moisture content in that potato chip that's going to give just the right level of crunchiness, but they have no idea where they're shipping it to. Are they shipping it to some environment that's really humid or an environment that's dry? That potato chip is either going to come out overly crisp or soggy if it's shipped in a container that's not sealed, or the bag that's not sealed. So, leaving material exposed to some form of ambient humidity, it will always equilibrate and have some amount of moisture. And if you need it to be arriving at your customer where that moisture is just right, you're going to have to ship it in a sealed container. If you don't care about the moisture, then you can just ship it as is.
How long does it only take to get that equilibrium, or is it dependent on the material?
Right, how long does it take to reach equilibrium? In many cases, that equilibrium will take several hours to reach. Okay, so think of your clothing hanging outside. It takes a while to dry based on natural heat transfer, but we're going to accelerate it, right? We're not going to be satisfied drying material based on equilibrium. We want to dry it to equilibrium, but we want to get to equilibrium fast. So what do we do? What are we going to do in our dryers to achieve equilibrium fast?
Yeah.
Apply heat, but we know that applying heat isn't just going to be good enough.
Remove the moisture.
We want to remove the moisture. How do you dry your clothes faster than if you dry it in the sun? Put it in a tumble dryer. What's going on in the tumble dryer?
You're feeding hot dry air.
Hot dry air is going to be added to it. What else is going on there? Everyone's doing this. You're creating some sort of velocity, right? You want to move the mass away from the surface so that you can allow heat transfer, mass transfer to occur faster. Right? So we're going to take a look at what that conceptual idea looks like in a tumble dryer. In fact, if you ever work in a pharmaceutical industry and you walk in and you ask where their dryer is, it's the machine that looks like a big tumble dryer. Because that's where they put on all their tablets and they just do exactly that, right? So no different in industry than it is in your home. So some other concepts we need to be comfortable with is the same isotherm just for a single species. What we have here is we've got a certain amount of moisture we can absorb onto the solid. So let's say we're at 30% humidity, and this amount over here on this isotherm is telling me what that moisture content is if I leave it for a long period of time in equilibrium. Now, I can always go add more moisture to that material. Right? So think of your clothing, you just take it out of the washing machine, it's wet, you've added moisture to it. There is this amount of moisture, let's take your wet t-shirt or your wet pants out of the dryer, out of the washing machine, you weigh the amount of water on that relative to the weight of the dry material, there's going to be some incremental amount of water. Your aim is to bring that down and dry that piece of fabric. Okay, so we call this amount the free moisture content, and this amount the equilibrium moisture content. So those are just the two terminology terms. There's two others over here, and they only apply when you're at 100% humidity. So at 100% humidity, we have what's called our bound moisture and our unbound moisture. So bound moisture is the moisture that's in that surface, in the material's capillaries and on its surface. So it's adsorbed right onto that surface, it's bound. Any additional moisture beyond that is what we call unbound moisture. So simply just two names, and these two terms only are used when we're operating in an environment of 100% humidity. Let's take a look at some other concepts that we need to be familiar with. Yes,
Mark? What does unbound moisture look like in terms of like the diagram that you got there?
It's simply excess moisture. So unbound moisture would be just there's additional water on here. So you could have all of that additional water on top of the equilibrium.
Just for the relative humidity, is that just
up
the environment? Is that like kind of what we're defining it as?
Yeah, I'm going to recap the relative humidity concept. So all those topics that you learned in second year, we're going to recover again just to make sure our terminology is right. So here's the viewpoint that you need to have when we're considering drying. When you're drying material, our aim is to bring the water out of the capillaries to the surface of the solid. So you've got to bring this water up to the surface of the solid. That's mass transfer inside the particle or inside the solid. Then that water, once it gets here to the surface, we need to vaporize it into the free vapor or into the bulk phase. So there's vaporization occurring there. The heat of vaporization is going to play an important role. Then we need to move that vapor into the bulk gas phase and get it away so that more moisture can come up and replace. So there's mass transfer inside the particle to the surface and then from the surface into the bulk. There's heat transfer as well. So to drive that mass transfer, what do we need for mass transfer to be driven? Or for mass transfer to occur? Concentration difference, okay? So it's going to move from a region of high concentration of water to low concentration. So there's a concentration difference. To encourage that difference to occur, in other words, to move this water off the solid into the vapor phase, we have to vaporize it. So there's a heat requirement there. The heat is coming from the ambient environment. So heat comes in, heats the solid, and provides that heat of vaporization, delta HVAP. Heat of vaporization is provided. Now, that heat doesn't just go into the water molecule and vaporize it. That heat also will heat up the solid itself. So you can't tell the heat where to go. heat transfer is just based on temperature difference. So it will vaporize a portion of the liquid. We call that latent heat. And then there's the other portion of the heat we call sensible heat. That's the heat that remains behind and heats up the solid. So those are two terms you've heard before. Maybe you just didn't put it into this context. So latent heat and sensible heat. So the key point is here, we've got to vaporize that liquid. That's going to require some energy. That energy has to come from somewhere. We're going to say and consider this an adiabatic system, so no external energy sources. So that energy must come from the airstream. As a result, the air is going to get cooled when this evaporates. So we're comfortable with this, very comfortable. It's what happens when you perspire. It's why when someone spills water on your sleeve, that piece of your arm feels cold. That heat to evaporate the water is coming from your body. It's being provided from the system itself. So you feel that cold sensation over there. It's because this air, that cooling has to come from the system itself, either from your arm or from the air, and it's cooling to provide that evaporation. Why our bodies perspire, so that we can cool down. Now, heat of vaporization is not a constant. It actually varies depending on the temperature that you're at. So if you're at 0 degrees Celsius, it's 2,500. If you're at 100 degrees, it's 2,260. And you can safely linearly interpolate between 0 and 100 with very, very small error. So just, we're going to require the heat of vaporization later on in our calculations. Because remember, heat of vaporization is that heat to take us from liquid phase to vapor phase over there. So recall our enthalpy diagrams. So as temperature rises, we get to a certain temperature, enthalpy, we've got that jump. That heat of vaporization is required to move us from liquid phase to solid to vapor phase. And that heat depends on the temperature we're at. I don't think I need to cover this. This is a lot of this is self-explanatory. We're comfortable with water and its three phases, boiling points, the triple point, critical points. Those are things we've seen before in the context of other materials. So just bear in mind then there's some obvious things that we can learn from this diagram. For one is that if we're at a constant temperature, we can move from vapor to liquid. That occurs along this vertical line. If we're at constant pressure and change the temperature, we're moving horizontally. So that's how to read this diagram. The other things that we can learn from this diagram is that at very high pressures, water is always in a solid form. At very low pressures, so these are close to vacuum, you can take water from solid phase to vapor phase directly without passing through liquid. So another sublimation. And then at temperatures we're commonly used to dealing and pressure we're commonly used to dealing with, we'll go through all three phases. So there's nothing there too much that's new for us. But it's helpful just to see it in context. Let's recap some other concepts that we need to be familiar with. The first is partial pressure. That's percentage moisture that's in the air exerts a pressure. So that water amount, or the pressure in the air due to water itself, is the partial pressure. What's useful for us is the vapor pressure. This is the pressure exerted on the solid surface onto the gas phase. So by that I mean, so here's my surface, and I've got liquid water on the solid, so there's a pressure being exerted from that liquid into the vapor, to move itself into the vapor phase. So if we look at this microscopically, we could consider that these molecules of water are moving off into the air around it. The pressure that those molecules exert, those water molecules exert, is the vapor pressure. And it's an indication of the substance's volatility. So for example, ethanol will have a higher vapor pressure than water. Water's vapor pressure is lower than ethanol, so we consider ethanol to be more volatile. It's got a greater pressure, it can escape more easily from that surface. And we can get evaporation occurring or encourage evaporation when the vapor pressure exceeds the partial pressure. So one way to visualize that is we've got our partial pressure here, so P, water is pushing down, we've got our vapor pressure pushing up. And that moisture will evaporate from the solid phase into the vapor phase when the vapor pressure exceeds the partial pressure. So this is my partial pressure. And one way to increase our vapor pressure is by heating that wet solid. So raising the temperature of it. Okay, remember these guys? Okay. Everything about this section of the course is solved on these diagrams. Simply because it contains all your mass and energy balances on this diagram. We've got temperature, and on our horizontal axis, giving us an indication of our energy in the system. And the vertical axis is humidity, mass of water per mass of dry air. So that's my mass information over there. And we're going to look at how that these diagonal lines, the saturation curves, were derived. We're going to look at what we mean by percentage humidity over there. So I'm going to hand these around. You feel free to take two of them. And they're also copied back to back. So you have four of these. If you take two sheets of paper, you'll have four of these diagrams for yourself to practice on. We're going to learn how to use them again. In the air around you, the regular thermometer, that's the temperature you're reading, is called the dry bulb temperature. Because that thermometer on the tip of it, so there's your scale over here with the demarcations, and there's some mercury or some sort of liquid over here that will expand proportional to temperature, that's in a dry environment. So around here is dry. We're going to see a wet bulb thermometer in a minute. So dry bulb temperature is nothing special, just your regular thermometer. Humidity is measured in units of mass per mass, mass of water vapor per mass of dry air. The units do not cancel. It's kilograms per kilograms, but it's two different kilograms of substance. So we cannot cancel those units. Unfortunately, many textbooks will call that humidity H, but they'll also go on and call enthalpy H, and then get a big mess of notation. So I've moved over to psi. Psi is the mass of water vapor per kilogram of dry air. And the notation that's used on your psychometric chart. Now, that's what's on your vertical axis. So vertical axis and horizontal axis, we have mass units on the vertical and temperature units on the horizontal. Now, if you take a piece of air there's only so much moisture that that air can hold. At a given temperature, you can add moisture to that air, keep raising the humidity of it, but at some point, you'll get to where it's reached its saturation. Okay, so think of the following. If you take a water bottle, you may buy a bottle of water, drink half of it, and you put half of it back in the fridge or just leave it on the countertop. If you come back to it later, you'll see inside the water bottle, above the water-air interface, that there's droplets of moisture. Okay. That pocket of air above the water interface is in saturation with the water below it. If you wanted to consider at a molecular level what's going on in that water bottle, so there's your bottle of water, here's your liquid. At the molecular level, you've got molecules of water going into the air above it, and you've got molecules of water going down. So that's closed. This is an equilibrium. The number of molecules going up into the vapor phase equals the number of molecules going down into the liquid phase. At saturation, that's the most amount of water we can hold in that body of air. So if we know that that saturation humidity, there's a certain kilograms of water in that saturated environments per kilograms of dry air at a given temperature. That's the most that we can hold in that air at a certain temperature. We can always ratio relative to that as our baseline. So if that's the most we can ever hold, the highest amount of humidity we can ever have then is 100%. We cannot have 110% humidity. So our most humidity is 100% and our lowest is zero, obviously. If that numerator, the actual humidity is 0 kilograms of water per dry air, we've got no humidity. So everything is always between 0 and 100. So that's what's in fact shown on these diagrams as well. So these curved lines tell you where your humidity is at a certain temperature. Or one way you can read it is that, say, at a particular temperature, you read up, and you can say, well, if that air is at a certain percentage humidity, say 30% humidity, you read horizontally, that's the mass of water per mass of dry air at 30%. You can also say, well, let's say at 30 degrees Celsius as an example, read up at 30 degrees Celsius, you can find out what the saturation humidity is. It's when this ratio is 100%, and then read horizontally and read off the mass of water per mass of dry air at saturation. So at 30 degrees, you can never hold more than that amount of water in the air. This graph, very importantly, is at atmospheric pressure. If I change the pressure in the system, these curves will change.
Everything's at the same pressure.
This is at one atmosphere. Okay, so if I'm operating a dryer at one atmosphere, I can use the psychrometric chart. If I decide to pressurize my system or draw a vacuum in it, then these curves will change.
Do
I need to worry about those adiabatic saturation curves? Yep, you do have to worry about them. We're going to use, that's exactly where everything is going to happen, is on those adiabatic saturation curves. So let's get to that. But there's one more definition we need. In case you forgot the definitions of partial pressure, you can also consider partial pressure to be related to humidity. Right? So partial pressure is telling me the pressure of moisture, the pressure in the air due to the moisture. Well, you can show then that the mass of water per mass of dry air, we call that psi, we call that humidity. You can show by a very simple mass balance in the vapor phase that it's the total pressure minus the partial pressure. So the denominator, the partial pressure, the numerator, and those constants you'll recognize. What are they? The molecular weights of air and water. Okay, so they're simply using the ideal gas law, you can derive a small mass balance in the vapor phase and relate humidity to partial pressure. So you can always move between one set of units and the other set of units.
Humidity that you described, is that the relative humidity?
So this value here?
Yeah.
No, so this humidity is just it's literally mass of water per mass of dry air. Relative humidity, or percentage humidity as it's also called, is the ratio between whatever your current humidity is divided by the maximum humidity possible. So this point over here, percentage humidity, you could also say that that is equal to relative humidity. It's another term for it. Lots of definitions coming up here over the next few slides. The next one is dew point. Dew point is telling you the temperature to which you can cool a body of air. So take an amount of air, trap it in some way. So there's moisture in that air at a certain temperature. If I start to cool that block of air down, eventually I'm going to see condensation forming on my container at the walls. So I've reached saturation. Okay, so it's a closed system, I cool it down. What is that temperature where I just start to see it occurring? Well, here we can figure this out. So take a look at your diagram. Let's take this example, air at 65 Celsius and 10% humidity. So if you draw on your diagram at 65, notice that these spacings are 2.5 degrees. So be careful with that. 65 degrees Celsius, if you have air at 10% humidity, you'll sometimes just drop off the word relative humidity. So at 10%, you read up to the 10% curve. So that's where I currently am. I look at the body of air at that temperature and at that humidity. If I cool it down, in order to achieve saturation, i.e. when condensation just starts to appear, it's telling me that I just simply read horizontally until I reach the saturation point. At that temperature is the temperature I need to cool down.
Yeah, it's a sort of dew point at 1 atm.
This is always at 1 atmosphere. We're only going to work at atmospheric pressure in this section of the course. But the concepts are no different if you take it up to lower or higher pressures. So this, we call this parcel of air, or this amount of air, when we started, had 0.021 kilograms of water per kilogram of dry air, or 21 grams of water per kilogram of dry air. So sometimes we're working grams per kilogram just to get these numbers a little higher. Okay, basic stuff, right, from your second year course. Let's introduce another concept, humid heat. This is a new one, perhaps. Humid heat is important for us. Humid heat is the analogous concept of heat capacity. So we understand that heat capacity is of material. Heat capacity is the amount of energy you need to add to an amount of material, 1 kilogram, to raise its temperature by 1 degree. So if I want to take an amount of air and increase its temperature by 1 degree Celsius, how much energy do I need to do that? Well, if we take, now we're not taking just air, we're taking air plus moisture. So here's my 1 kilogram of air plus moisture. So there's a certain amount, at the molecular level, I've got a certain mass of water in there, and I have the rest of that kilogram of mass represents pure air. If I want to raise that whole kilogram by 1 degree Celsius, I have to raise both the air and the moisture's temperature. So that's exactly what this equation tells me. 1.005 is the heat capacity of dry air with no moisture in it. So that 1.005 has units. It's units of kilojoules per kilogram air Kelvin. And this heat or energy required is going to be dependent on the amount of moisture originally present. So if there was no moisture present in this original block, I would only, my heat capacity is this 1.005. But if I've got more moisture present, I'm going to require additional heat because I also have to heat the water component or the water fraction. And one way we can conveniently represent that is with the humidity sine. So sine is units of kilograms water per kilogram dry air, 1.88, that constant also has units of kilojoules per kilogram water vapor Kelvin. So that's easy to read. This is simply the heat capacity of water, 1.88 kilojoules per kilogram water vapor Kelvin. And the product of those two summed up gets us the overall heat capacity of that air-water mixture. Why do we need to know this? Why is CS going to be important for us? Right, totally going to be used to calculate the energy required to dry our solid. Okay. The heat capacity to raise that mixture by 1 degree Celsius is an important point. So here's a one way we can derive some of that terminology. We'll work with it. Consider a box where we're spraying air, water into, say, a very fine mist. So in other words, we're spraying this liquid water and it's going to evaporate into that region. We're going to have air coming in at some given humidity and at some temperature. So if I've got air coming in and I'm evaporating water into that air in an adiabatic zone or adiabatic boundary or some container, what's going to happen to that water, the liquid water? Spraying liquid water in, what do we expect to happen to it?
Some portion of it's going to vaporize.
Okay, some of it's going to vaporize. So some of that liquid water is going to go into the vapor phase. Most of it is just going to land up here at the bottom. But some portion of it is going to go into the vapor phase. Where's the energy going to come from to do that? From the air itself. Okay, so the temperature of this air leaving is going to drop. So if we're vaporizing some of this liquid water into the vapor phase, that energy has to come from somewhere. It comes from the system itself. So the system will cool down. So TS leaving is going to be lower than the inlet temperature coming in. What's the humidity of this stream leaving? It's up, because we've now raised the amount of moisture per kilogram of air. So psi S, we call our saturation humidity. At equilibrium, if we allow this to reach saturation, psi S, that's the most amount of moisture, kilograms of water per kilogram air that we can hold. So psi S is going to be higher than psi, and T is going to be lower than, TS is going to be smaller than T. Yes,
CS for the, is that the humid heat or is that the capacity?
So CS, we're going to look at that in a minute. CS is telling me the humid heat is the energy to raise 1 kilogram of this mixture by 1 degree Celsius. So take this mixture in here is a mixture of water vapor, so water in the vapor phase as well as air. If I want to raise that mixture by 1 degree Celsius, how much energy do I add to that?
CS is the energy.
Okay, so now if we take that diagram, think of it conceptually this way, we've plotted temperature on this axis and psi on the vertical axis. So let me take TS then to be, it's the temperature leaving, let's consider the inlet temperature. So I'm coming in at some inlet temperature T and with some humidity psi. My inlet point, so some temperature T and some humidity psi. Where's the outlet going to be relative to this point? The outlet temperature and outlet humidity. Somewhere here, up. Okay, so somewhere over here, we're going to have TS and psi S. And the process of going from my inlet to my outlet is simply a straight line. So I'm adiabatically removing the heat and I'm adding moisture. So notice heat transfer and mass transfer both occurring here. I'm losing heat, but I'm gaining mass, and I move along that curve. That slope then, that's telling me how I move from one point to the other, very easy to derive. And that slope is, in fact, I'll go through this derivation in a minute, but that slope is simply these adiabatic saturation curves you have on the diagram in front of you. So here's my inlet condition, and I move along these parallel lines to find where I end up. So I end up at my saturation temperature. I cannot go beyond this point, and I can then determine what my saturation humidity is. Okay, and if you happen to be on a point where you're not on one of these diagonal lines, you simply interpolate between the existing ones.
So if you're doing the separation that way, it's just an MSA that you're using.
MSA? ESA. Energy. You're adding energy to move the vapor from the salt, from its liquid form into the vapor form.
With energy from the air.
Yeah, energy, yeah. So it's an energy separating agent. This. So remember, our separating agents are something we add to the system in order to cause the separation. In this, in context of drying, our separating agent is energy. Sorry,
Should we talk about assuming that you're going to that saturation point, or could you go, do you have to fall at the 100% humidity, or could you fall somewhere else?
Oh, good point. How do we know we could go this far and not somewhere over here?
Because you want to make it.
Yeah.
Because there's still liquid left in that box. So if you still have capacity to take on liquid.
Right, so the assumption is, with this derivation, is we're allowing enough time for this to reach equilibrium and to get saturated. But in practical situations, we don't have enough time, or we may only reach 80% of the amount. So that will, you won't reach equilibrium, and then that you can't make that assumption.
But you still find it the same way.
Absolutely. You must, to get from T, if you're going to work in an adiabatic system, you will go along that line. If that's the path you will travel. Yes, Mark.
So if it's then. It's an ESA, how is it still an adiabatic situation? The adiabatic doesn't have any energy.
Right, so in other words, the energy is coming from the system itself, or it's cooling itself down in order to create the heat.
That's no external.
Yeah. So what we can do is a very simple enthalpy balance. So remember, enthalpy balances are always done relative to some baseline or some reference temperature. And if I conveniently choose my reference temperature to be Ts, then I can simply ignore any of the liquid phase species, because all the liquid phases are Ts. My inlet water coming in is here as a Ts. So that I can ignore that, and then simply do my enthalpy balance on my vapor phase. So enthalpy balance here on the vapor phase is how much energy is required to move from my reference Ts up to T. Is that amount? That's going to raise my liquid from Ts up to the temperature T. Then I also have to vaporize that amount of moisture. So the amount of moisture I need to vaporize is given by sine times delta H of that. So the enthalpy leaving, I can calculate in the same way. But this case, it happens because of my reference point, that term is zero. And then simply doing a ratio of those two equations, I can then derive the change between psi and psi s over t minus ts. That slope then is telling me what that slope is. I can calculate that slope is a function of cs and delta h back. Okay, so very, very interesting that slope can be derived. And you'll notice that the psi values are pretty small. That slope is mostly constant, which you see in fact in the diagram in front of you. That those lines are mostly parallel. So what we're going to do next class is we'll solve a problem on this and then understand at the molecular level what drying is.